All right. Good afternoon. Today I'll be talking about using physical gene proximity to predict gene function in green algae. So algae are distantly related to most characterized proteins from model organisms, making sequence similarity-based approaches alone unreliable. For example, between a quarter and a half of an algal genome may have no sequence similarity at all to proteins in the PFAM domain database. So in order to unlock this reservoir of unique functional capacity in algae, we turn to utilizing multiple sources of evidence to provide support for functional predictions. And today I'm going to focus on my work with conserved gene neighborhoods. Unfortunately, I won't be able to get to my work on protein fusions, but if you're interested in that, please see me at my poster tonight. So gene proximity has been used as a method for functional inference in prokaryotes for decades. Some of this early work searched for pairs of close homologs within a set distance forming a neighborhood which may be functionally linked. And these are not necessarily operons. And so you can start to build these phylogenetic profiles with, in this example, genes in purine biosynthesis across the top, and they're clustering in various prokaryotes. In this case, the colors represent the distinct neighborhoods. So for example, Bacillus subtilis, all the genes in purine biosynthesis are in one neighborhood, whereas in Deinococcus, PURQ and L are in one neighborhood, while E and K are in a separate neighborhood. And so you can start to see patterns emerging, like this uncharacterized protein that tends to cluster with genes in purine biosynthesis, leading to the hypothesis that this gene is also involved in this pathway. And sure enough, it was shown that this gene was involved in purine biosynthesis and the annotation accordingly updated. And so can this strategy be applied to eukaryotic genomes? In recent years, there has been increased reports of gene neighborhoods in eukaryotic genomes. They may be involved in primary or secondary metabolism. Unlike bacterial operons, they're not polycistronic and may have intervening genes, and they may or may not be co-expressed together. Current methods to detect gene neighborhoods in eukaryotes often require either transcriptome data or are sequence similarity-based approaches, which may not be applicable to non-model organisms like algae. So instead, I've returned to some of the ideas from the early prokaryotic work and the search for proximal orthologous genes that form conserved gene neighborhoods in order to reach the ultimate goal of identifying neighborhoods that are likely to be functionally relevant, rather than to identify the extent of gene clustering in these algae. And so I looked at 9 chlorophyte algae. Their locations on this tree are denoted by the stars and a 5-gene window. And I've used 3 strategies to pull out these potentially functionally relevant neighborhoods. The first is to search for conserved proximal orthologous gene pairs in a minimum of 4 chlorophyte species and in 2 taxonomic classes. So this is an effort to reduce the effects of background synteny. The second strategy is to look for co-occurring gene pairs, meaning that these genes are clustering in each of the species in which they are found. And by doing this, I can relax some of the other more stringent parameters, like only requiring 3 orthologous gene pairs instead of 4. And finally, to search for proximal orthologous gene pairs between more distantly related organisms, so to select for gene pairs conserved between chlorophytes and a charophyte alga. And so this has resulted in several gene neighborhoods, several of which are also potentially functionally relevant. And I'm going to talk about 2 of these today. So the first story I'll talk about is a potential new pathway for a microsporin-related amino acid compound. So these are UV-absorbing compounds, nature's sunscreen, found in a variety of organisms. And if you look at the figure on the left, the solid circles represent genes that are found within this 5-gene window. The striped circles represent that the gene is found in the genome, however not in the 5-gene window, and the open circles mean that the gene is not found in the particular genome. And so this cluster was found looking for co-occurring and co-located genes. This cluster was also found to be co-expressed in chromochloris under oxidative stress conditions. And so then looking more closely at the phylogeny of the genes in this pathway, we notice that the green algal pathway appears to be a mixture of known pathways. So the first two genes are more similar to the vertebrate pathway, while the second two genes, MYSC and the O-methyltransferase, which is similar to MYSB of cyanobacteria. However, this green algal pathway is different from either of those known pathways and differs from the known red algal pathway. And so we think that the green algae may be producing a green algal specific MAA compound. So in terms of genome mining, this may be of interest as a potential high value co-product. And work is underway with one of our collaborators in Trent Northern's lab at Lawrence Berkeley National Lab to identify the MAA compounds in chromochloris. So this is some preliminary results of the MAAs detected in chromochloris by mass spec. In addition, we've expressed each of these genes sequentially in E. coli in order to better elucidate this pathway. So the second story I'm going to talk about today is arsenic detoxification. Again, looking for co-occurring and co-located genes. We see a cluster of three arsenic-related genes in three species. These genes, ARS, B, H, and C, also form an operon in certain bacteria and have been shown to be involved in arsenic detoxification in bacteria. In addition, what emerged next was a second arsenic detoxification cluster. And so these genes are present in the species that do not contain the first pathway. These genes are also linked in arsenic operons in bacteria and include GAPDH, which is a glycolytic enzyme, and ARSJ, a transporter. Additionally, in Chlamydomonas, we saw a paralog of a characterized arsenate reductase in this arsenic neighborhood. And finally, surprisingly, we see a second glycolytic enzyme, phosphoglycerate kinase, in this arsenic gene neighborhood. So this leads us to the question, what is the role of PGK in arsenic tolerance? And to test this, we ordered the Chlamydomonas mutants available for our genes of interest and tested them under sodium arsenate stress. And we can see the ARSJ, the transporter protein, does show a growth defect under arsenate stress. And in addition, the PGK mutant also shows a similar phenotype. So this verifies the role of PGK in arsenic tolerance. However, the question remains as to what is the exact function of PGK in this pathway. Is it moonlighting as an enzyme in glycolysis and also in arsenic detoxification? Or is this an example of neofunctionalization? Because those four species with PGK in the gene neighborhood also contain two copies of this gene. So in addition to identifying a new role for a well-known glycolytic enzyme, this strategy has better annotated two other genes in this gene neighborhood. And very quickly, I want to go over some evolutionary trends that are coming out of this work, looking at the most similar non-algal homologs for the genes in 183 neighborhoods. We see that the majority of them are plant-like. And then looking more closely at the phylogenies of the pathways that I spoke about today, and also an oxalate metabolism pathway. This was the gene fusion that I don't have time to talk about today. We see a couple patterns emerging, including this link between chromochloris, coccomyxa, and klebsormidium, meaning that these gene neighborhoods have been maintained over long evolutionary time periods before the streptophyte chlorophyte split, so about a billion years of divergence. And in addition, we see some evidence for convergent evolution of pathways. This was the MAA example, so genes from possibly multiple different origins are coming together to produce a product similar to known MAA pathways. So in summary, physical gene associations can be used to decipher functional associations. Gene neighborhoods are widely distributed and conserved in green algae. They may contain advantageous genes like detoxification, and there's some evidence for co-expression. Some genes may be of multiple sources, and there's some evidence for convergent evolution. And these gene neighborhoods may also include moonlighting genes functioning in multiple pathways. And so by casting a wide net and using the available omics data, we're able to prioritize targets for experimental characterization. And in this way, we can get at that untapped functional capacity potential in green algae. And we go from the unknown to a well-supported annotation. And so here I've only used 10 green algal genomes. And with the increased availability of high-quality algal and non-volatile organism genomes, the strategy will only become more powerful. And so I'd like to thank my advisor, Kristen Blaby, Ian Blaby, Trent Northern, and Yuntao Hu for their work in the MAA characterization. And if you're interested in hearing about my gene fusion work, please see me at my poster number 57 tonight. Thank you.
So I was just wondering if your method can distinguish pseudogenes from active genes, or whether you definitely need experimental data to verify that.
Sorry, could you repeat that?
So can you distinguish pseudogenes from active genes just based on the computational work itself?
I'm not sure. I think you would need experimental verification.
Okay, that's fine. Again, pseudogenes that, I mean, I'm sure you know pseudogenes which are not active. So you definitely need the experimental data to verify whether the gene is actively expressing, right?
Yes.
All right, thanks.
Thank you, I appreciate it. Thanks.
I have a question. I'm impressed by seeing that you've had this. You do these comparisons of all these different subgroups of green algae, and you see that some that they have in several cases you see complete conservation between these different branches, but then also complete loss or absence in close relatives of them. And I was wondering how do you explain that, or how do you distinguish that from some other explanation, like I don't know, horizontal gene transfer or something like that.
So those looking more closely at the phylogenies of those pathways, they did not look like horizontal gene transfers. Many of them looked like they were plant origins. And I'm not exactly sure how you would explain the conservation over long evolution time periods, especially since many of them have different varying habitats. So we're looking more into that.